I am not my own. I give up control. You can take me where you will. To be used for you or laid aside for you. I am empty to be filled on the altar now forever. I am laying down my life for your glory. May my song be, I am only all for Christ. If I have all things, or if I have nothing, only you have all my life. Now in heaven and earth, oh, may my voice be heard. I am yours and you are mine. On the altar, now forever, I am laying down my life for your glory. May my song be, I am only all for Christ. I am only all for Christ. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor
good morning, until all on the altar we lay. That's where we're going this morning. And I want to introduce your newest brother in Christ, Zach Bender, laid it all on the altar Wednesday night. He was baptized. Give him a hand. There you go. If you're a guest this morning, welcome to Twickenham. We are really glad to have you here. How are we doing on the balcony? Not too well, huh? Hey, glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. If you have a prayer request or a concern that you want us to be praying about, there's a card on the seat in front of you. You can fill that out and put it in the collection plate when it passes a little later in the service. We'll be praying about those as early as tomorrow morning as a staff, and we'll pass those out to our shepherds as well. If you want the whole church praying about it, let us know, and we'll make sure everybody is aware of it. Otherwise, just indicate private, and we'll keep that just in-house. But glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. We are going to be singing some songs this morning. We're going to be participating in sort of a symbolic ceremony that we do every Sunday called Communion or the Lord's Supper. Some churches call it the Eucharist, the Thanksgiving, and it's an opportunity for us to remember what Jesus did for us on the ultimate altar, the cross. You are welcome to join us in that if you wish. That's between you and the Lord, but we'd be happy to have you join us in that ceremony. And then we'll have a time of teaching. I'll be sharing a word with you from Scripture, from the book of Genesis chapter 13. Just really glad you're here today. Let's take a moment, stand, greet each other in the name of the Lord with a hug and a handshake, and then we'll get on with our time of praise.
His holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Let's celebrate the satisfaction we have. Who can satisfy my soul like you? Who on earth could comfort me and love me like you do? Who could ever be more faithful, true? I will trust in you. I will trust in you, my my very own. Compassion on his children. So the Lord has compassion on those who fear him, for he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. Would you be seated as we take our offering and as we think about his love? Think about his love.
Think about his goodness. Think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. How could I forget his love? Lamb of God, by his
have sung about altars. We have read about remembering and not forgetting. We have considered the great love that God has shown to us. Altars are all about remembering and sometimes about forgetting, because the sacrifice that is made on them reminds us of our sin. And it reminds us that it is forgotten because of the blood of Jesus. So this morning, we celebrate and share the ultimate altar, and that is the cross. And we remember what was done for us. And we take all heart and confidence in the grace of our Lord to know that those things are forgotten. Let's share in the altar as we take the bread and the cup this morning. Let's pray.
Holy God, we thank you for everything that you've done for us. Father, we are thankful for sending your Son to die on the cross for us. Father, as we focus at this time on the altar, Father, as we focus on the cross, help us to remember the body that was broken for us, Father, that gives us the ultimate hope, which is a chance to live with you forever. God, thank you for Jesus. In his name I pray, amen.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree, his body bound and drenched in tears, they lay him down. For
Father, thank you. You. To remember the blood that was spilt on the altar. The blood that was spilt willingly and the blood that cleanses us from our sin. Father, we thank you for this gift. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King.
Let's stand.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise forevermore, for endless days, we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord.
want, you can turn over to Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 13. That's the first book of the New Testament, Old Testament. Sorry. The preacher gets the Bible books wrong a lot. So Genesis chapter 13, very first book in the Bible. Comes right after introduction. Preface. It's actually a Hebrew word that means before the beginning. So, hey, yesterday, around 50 or so of you gathered here in the morning and put together bags for homeless folks. And a lot of you brought in supplies over the last several weeks and filled up these boxes that were in the lobbies. And yesterday, our team was able to put together about 110 bags. The goal was 100. We hit 110. And they distributed those to folks on the street yesterday. So Mike and Jeannie Weirley, thank you for taking the lead on that. And the Clarks, thank you for taking a lead on that. Steve and Ann. So let's just give those folks a hand and thank the Lord for our being able to participate in that. It's a good thing. So you and I, Americans, we buy gym memberships in January. Then we spend $10 billion a year on self-help books and $60 billion a year on weight loss. One study suggested that in 2013, which is the last year for which we have numbers, 101 million Americans saw a counselor. Some of you didn't and needed to, okay? That's a third of Americans went and saw a counselor. And according to Barna, 55% of Americans attended church services in the last 6 months with varying frequency. Some of you weren't here as much as others. Hint, hint. Why do we do all that? I mean, why do we go to the gym and try to lose weight and read self-help books and go to counselors and go to church? Why do we do all of those things and many, many more things? The bottom line is we want to be better people. That's what it is. We want to be better people. Nearly everybody wants to be a better person, and everybody talks about it. I mean, even famous people. Michael J. Fox. A lot of you guys will remember Michael J. Fox. Look at what he said. He's trying to put a positive spin on this disease that he has, Parkinson's. And he, by the way, he's a great guy, and he has, I think what he says is right. It's made me a better person, a better husband, a better father, overall better human being. And he is a good guy. He wants to be better. Martha Stewart said this, "I think I'm a better person for having given serious thought and effort to gardening." Martha needed to spend some more time in the garden. Look, I don't believe that at all, because if that were true, I would have been Mother Teresa by the age of 12, because my dad made us work in the garden, and I swore I'd never have a garden after that, and I don't. I believe that if you want to have vegetables, you can go to the grocery store. They have a nice selection. My favorite is Jim Gaffigan. Jim Gaffigan's the father of five. He said, "My kids have made me a better person. I only need like 34 more of them to be a really good guy." This morning we're going to talk about how to be a better human being, okay? Last week, we spent some time down in Egypt with our current guide on the journey, Abraham. In the last 10 verses of Genesis 12, they're just a low point in Abraham's life. He arrives in the promised land only to discover that it's more appropriately named famine land. There's a huge famine going on in the land. And if you're basing your subsistence, your existence in an agrarian economy, then that's a problem. The journey took him to a place he didn't expect to go. And that happens to us too. We enter into arrangements and relationships. We make plans or commitments. We dream dreams or take risks. and then things don't turn out as we had hoped, and we have a choice to respond to that new reality either with anxiety, with total fear of danger, or we can respond with hope, in total confidence in God's deliverance. When Abraham confronted that new reality, he responded out of anxiety and fear and a lack of trust or faith in God. The only possibility he could imagine was danger. My family's going to starve here in the promised land. And so he fled the famine and went down to Egypt. But before he arrived in Egypt, he imagined yet another danger. The Egyptians could not help but notice how gorgeous was his wife Sarai. They'd take her and kill him. And so he asked her to lie. Tell them, you're my sister. So when they take you, I'll be well treated. Husband of the year. They did notice. They did take her. And he was treated well, very well. He was showered with gifts. And I don't mean the kind that you get at the Target gift registry. I mean cattle and sheep and donkeys and gold and silver and then servants to manage it all for just a little bit. It looked like Abraham's anxious plan and deceit were going to work out just fine until God plagued Pharaoh's house with sickness for inadvertently stealing another man's wife. When Pharaoh found out what Abraham had done, he kicked him out of Egypt. That's really what happened. He kicked him out. But Abraham got to keep all the stuff. That's the last 10 verses of Genesis chapter 12. Abraham is anxious, faithless, prayerless, dishonest, selfish, self-centered, manipulative, willing to sacrifice others to save his own sorry hide, takes matters into his own hands, and profits by deception. You've heard of the 10 commandments? Those are the 10 failures. He's not someone you'd want to befriend in Genesis chapter 12. He is not somebody you'd want to be married to. You wouldn't want to even see him at the family reunion. You wouldn't want to do business with him. You certainly wouldn't want to follow him on a journey. Yet as faithless as Abraham was, and here's where we landed last week. This is where we need to land every week. As faithless as Abraham was, God was faithful to him, just like he is faithful to me and to you. When we are faithless, God is faithful. But you get to Genesis chapter 13, and all of that changes. Not the God is faithful part, the Abraham is a failure part. It all changes. Abraham is completely altered. For every negative thing you can say about him in chapter 12, there are three good things to say about him in chapter 13. And I want to know why. What altered Abraham? What changed him from a deceiver to a decent person? What made him a better man? I think we all want to know that secret. That's why we go to the gym and buy the books and watch the TED Talks and do all of the things we do to try to be better people. We want to know how. So let's see what we can discover by looking in the Bible. Genesis chapter 13. Okay, just to remind you, Abram has been invited to leave Egypt. So he heads back to the land to which God had originally called him, the promised land. This is Genesis chapter 13, verse 1. So, Abram went up from Egypt to the Negev with his wife and everything he had. And Lot went with him. Lot is Abraham's nephew, his brother's son. We're not going to talk much about Lot because he is really not key to this story. We'll come back to him another time. So a lot of folks are interested in him, but we're not going to get him much today. But that's Abraham's nephew. Verse 2, Abraham had become very wealthy in livestock and in silver and gold. From the Negev, he went from place to place until he came to Bethel, to the place between Bethel and Ai, where his tent had been earlier, and where he had first built an altar. There Abram called on the name of the Lord. First thing we need to notice is Abraham's changed economic status. He left Canaan, where he discovered the famine, a refugee, and when he comes back, he is rolling in it. That part in verse 2 where it says he had become very wealthy, a Jewish version of Genesis 13 translates that as heavy. He was heavy in livestock and gold. Right about here, you might expect me to tell you that prosperity won't solve your problems. I mean, that's what preachers are supposed to say, right? I mean, the good preachers. We're supposed to tell you that prosperity won't solve your problems. We're going to come back to wealth in just a minute, but can we just be real honest here? Prosperity does solve a lot of problems. I mean, it does. It can eliminate a lot of worries. Food, shelter, transportation, health, housing, education. If you no longer have to worry about how to stock the fridge or where you're going to go when it gets cold, that eliminates a lot of anxiety right there. If you can afford to see the doctor and pay for your medications, that's going to eliminate a lot of anxiety for you. So prosperity does solve some problems. The problem with prosperity, though, is that while it eliminates some problems, it creates others, and the problems prosperity creates cannot be solved by prosperity. Okay? Prosperity does solve some problems, but the problem is it creates others, and the problems prosperity creates, more prosperity will not solve. For example, look at verse 5. Now Lot, the nephew, who was moving with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. So Abram has been prospered, and so has Lot. Lot has become a very wealthy, powerful man himself. But the land could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. That's a first world problem they're having. And quarreling arose between Abram's herders and Lot's. The Canaanites and Perizzites were also living in the land at the time. You remember that movie Open Range with Kevin Costner and Robert Duvall? Like free grazers move into this area where ranchers have settled and this turf war erupts over resources. That's what's happening here in Genesis chapter 13. The Canaanites and Perizzites have already been there for a long time with their sheep and their cattle, and then in comes Abram and Lot with their heavy herds and flocks, and the land is having a real hard time keeping up with the demand. Lot's cowhands get into a fuss with Abram's cowhands, and we're one insult away from a gunfight at the Bethel Corral. Prosperity has created a problem it cannot solve. Now, the culturally normative way of dealing with a situation like this back in those days would have been for the most powerful person to stake his claim and invite the party or parties beneath his status to find a new place to graze their animals. That would have been Abraham. He was older, he was richer, he was more powerful. He had the special relationship with God. So if this scenario plays out in the normal way, Abraham is going to say to Lot, his nephew, look, the country is getting pretty crowded. You need to pack up all your stuff and move on. Which is exactly what the Genesis 12 Abraham would have done. The Genesis 12 Abraham would have said, son, this country's not big enough for the both of us. Have a nice trip. But that's not what the Genesis 13 Abraham does. Look at verse 8. So Abram said to Lot, let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herders and mine, for we are close relatives. is not the whole land before you. Let's part company. If you go to the left, I'll go to the right. If you go to the right, I'll go to the left. In other words, Lot, you get dibs. You go first. You pick where you want to live, where you want to graze your herds. I'll take whatever is left. If you haven't read or if you haven't watched Simon Sinek presentation on leadership or read one of his books, it's Simon, S-I-N-E-K. You need to know who he is. The title of his second book is Leaders Eat Last. That's precisely what Abraham does right here. He eats last. I want to know why. What motivated him to do that? I mean, one chapter back, he is shoving his wife to the back of the line. And now, he's shoving his nephew to the front. In Genesis 12, he's making all of his decisions out of panic and anxiety and fear, and now he's acting out of hope and confidence and faith. In Genesis 12, he was selfish and willing to sacrifice others. Now he's magnanimous and selfless. Then he was taking matters into his own hands. Now he's trusting the hand of God. What happened? It's like in Genesis 12, he had a demon. Or according to ancient Arabian mythology, they called it an ifrit. He had a jinn who was controlling his life, and now he's different. What altered Abraham? What made him a better person? Well, there is the little matter of money. I mean, then Abraham didn't have any. Now he's nouveau riche. Then his wallet was light. Now he's heavy with gold and silver. I mean, wouldn't you find it easier to be nice to other people and trust in God if you were well provisioned? Except that neither scripture nor common experience back that up. Mark chapter 10. Jesus encounters a rich man, invites him to be a disciple. The rich man refuses. In response, Jesus tells his disciples, this is Mark chapter 10, verse 23, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. In verse 25, he says, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Wealth and faith don't always play well together. Which kind of makes you wonder about the prosperity preachers who are always claiming that God wants to make you a millionaire. I'm wondering, why would God give you something that makes it hard for you to enter into his kingdom? But even if scripture didn't say anything about it, you and I both know that you're more likely to find faith in a humble home than a palatial mansion. Those who have it all have a difficult time recognizing their need for God. Those of us who have a lot have a hard time recognizing our need for God. Those who are accustomed to getting our way have a hard time submitting to the authority of another. So this newfound wealth is not what made Abraham a better person. And it's probably not going to make you and me a better person either. What did? What made him a better person? There's a clue in verse 4. When Abram returns to Canaan, he arrives at the place where, here it is, he had first built an altar. There Abram called on the name of the Lord. An altar was a type of monument a person would build to commemorate an encounter with God. It could be just a simple mound of earth. It could be a single stone that's erected. You know, sometimes we sing, here I raise my Ebenezer. We didn't sing that this morning because nobody knows what an Ebenezer is. An Ebenezer is a stone of help. It's just an altar, just a big stone. Sometimes it would be a pile of stones. So altars could be anything. Sacrifices were offered on altars, and memories were made and preserved at altars. The altar to which Abraham returns was built by him after he first arrived in the promised land back in Genesis chapter 12, verse 7, he built an altar. God appeared to him and reiterated the promise that he had made originally. And so when God appears to Abraham and reiterates the promise that he makes in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, Abram builds this altar so that he won't forget. Now, fresh from his failed sojourn in Egypt, he comes back to Canaan and he finds that first altar, and I think that's what altered Abraham. That's what changed him. That's what made him a better person. How? The altar altered him because it reminded him of God's promise. I will make you into a great nation. That's what God had said. I will bless you. I will make you a blessing. I will give this land to your offspring. That was the promise. And with that promise, now fresh again in his mind, Abraham was able to respond to conflict with grace. Could that help you? Would it help you to be able to respond to conflict with grace? That's what Abraham's altar did for him. Now he was able to experience the unexpected with inexplicable peace. Would it help you to be able to encounter an unexpected moment and respond to that in peace? When resources were limited, he was able to imagine the possibility of provision. The altar reminded him of the promise, and the promise altered his ego. He was empowered to eat last, to let others go first, to give away instead of to grasp, to be magnanimous instead of manipulative. The altar made him better. Imagine how far from the promise Abram would have wandered, how far from the promise the journey would have taken him if there had been nothing to alter his course and change his direction. You see, we think that a journey is only about looking ahead. And if you're on a journey, you're putting one foot in front of the other, right? You're moving forward. Your entire being is future-oriented. The journey is all about what's over the next hill or around the next bend. But journeys are not just about where we are going. They are as much about where we have been. And if we have built altars along the way, marking the moments we encountered God, we can look back now and then and be reminded of things that we've forgotten, redirected to the right path, reoriented to what matters. You have some altars. Your baptism, the altar of baptism, reminds us of God's promise. In your baptism, you were buried with Christ. You were made alive with Christ. God forgave you all your sins. That's what Paul says in Colossians chapter 2. In your baptism, you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's what Peter said in Acts chapter 2. The altar of baptism means that you have nothing to prove and nothing to fear. And that makes people better, when they have nothing to prove and nothing to fear. The altar of communion, what we experienced just a few moments ago, reminds us of God's love. In the Lord's Supper, we remember a love so great that God gave His only begotten Son, that very famous passage from John 3:16, so that all who believe might have eternal life. At the altar of communion, we remember that by His death, burial, and resurrection, Jesus broke down the walls that divide us by race and gender and politics. The altar of communion means that hostility has been put to death and that peace has been preached, and that makes people better. The altar of prayer reminds us that God listens. When you pray, the Lord is near. Anxiety about anything is replaced by a peace that transcends everything. And that peace guards your heart like a sentry. The altar of prayer means that you are not alone in your trouble and that your trouble will not have the last word. And that makes people better. At the end of Genesis 13, after Abram has allowed Lot to choose the best, God reaffirms and expands his promise to Abram. He says, "Lift up your eyes from where you are and look north and south and east and west. All the land you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. I will make your offspring like the dust of the earth, so that if the dust could be counted, then your offspring could be counted." That's an extravagant promise. And then Abraham packed up his tents, and he moved out with his herds. He let Lot have the good land, and he traveled 30 miles to a new place called Mamre. And you know what he did there? He built an altar to the Lord. I'm wondering if you've had an encounter with God recently, an instance when you felt his presence, heard his promise in the word of a friend, or the lyric of a song, or the silence of the morning, the joy of a moment, or the conviction that rises when we realize that our ultimate altar was shaped like a cross. That's where we lay our anxieties. That altar, that cross, is where we lay our desire for control. That altar, that cross, is where we lay our regrets. That's where neither our prosperity nor our poverty define us. We sang a new song earlier. I want us to go back to that song now and let this song be for you and me a pledge to leave it all at that cross-shaped altar. Let's sing, and then I've got one more word I want to share with you.
I am not my own. I give up control. You can take me where you
ago, before Lisa and I joined you on this journey, we bought a wind chime. It's very well crafted. It's tuned to the musical key of C, and it emits a strong deep, resonant song when the wind blows. We hung it on our back porch back in Georgia at the house we called our healing house. And it hangs on our back porch here in Huntsville. We bought it as an anniversary present to ourselves. It's very special because there was a time when we were not sure there would be any more anniversaries to celebrate. But by that point, God had done his healing work in my heart and in our marriage. We can not only imagine many future anniversaries, we actually look forward to them. That wind chime is a reminder that I have been altered by God, by his mercy. Let me leave you with one question and one suggestion. Here's the question. That wind chime is a personal altar for us. Where are your personal altars? The things that remind you when you see them or hear them of God's provision and God's promise, of God's mercy and grace and healing. Where are your altars? Here's the suggestion. If you don't have any, and even if you do, it's a good idea to start building some. Your future self will thank you. Tom Brown's going to lead us in the closing prayer. Let's stand together. Tom, come on up. I want to urge you to take a look in the bulletin for any news that may be coming up. Check our website. So glad you were here. Let's go out this week and make a difference in our community for Jesus Christ.
Let's go to our Father in prayer. God, I just thank you for loving us no matter what. There are so many people out there in this audience today, and I'm going to pray just specifically for this group, and then we're going to reach out into the world. But we're dealing with some things that are making us hurt, and they're giving us trials. Lord, just help every one of them remember and do your part to be part of God's message, that whatever that trouble is, it will not have the last word. Jesus Christ is the last word, and when we bow ourselves to him, we will prevail. Just build some altars this week, guys. Let's go out there, put others first, respond to conflict with grace. Lord knows I need help with that. Lord, please just fill us with your spirit this week, and let us know that we are yours, and that we're here to invite everyone else to be a part of you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.